The demonstrations and the violence brought the Maryland National Guard here in force to maintain order. The guardsmen still stand watch in Cambridge, olive drab dressing for deep racial wounds that have not yet healed. The desegregation campaign was organized by the so-called Cambridge Nonviolent Action Committee, with total integration as its goal. It was headed by Gloria Richardson, a militant leader. Along the way, nonviolent action too often became violent. The first explosion came in June, after a long series of demonstrations, arrests, more demonstrations, more arrests, truces, stalled negotiations, broken promises, and charges of bad faith from both sides. Rioting rocked the city on June 11th, following a Negro march to protest against the sentencing of two juvenile demonstrators to correction homes. 2 days later, a huge throng of counter-demonstrating whites were blocked by police and state troopers from surging into the Negro district. With the city on the verge of war, Governor Miller Taws ordered the National Guard into Cambridge to maintain a civilian and military government. Modified martial law, including a nighttime curfew, smothered the violent outbreak. During the next 3 weeks, negotiations sputtered and stalled, while tensions smoldered beneath the tending of the guard. On July 8th, the guard was pulled out. Demonstrations resumed immediately. A corner restaurant known as Dizzyland became one of the most improbable focal points of national attention when owner Robert Faisenfeld smeared a kneeling demonstrator with raw egg. Afterward, NBC reporter Jack Perkins talked with a repentant Mr. Faisenfeld.
You saw yourself on television last Monday night, saw a very hateful man. Are you that kind of man?
Well, I would say I'm just an ordinary American who feels that he has a right to defend his livelihood. I hope it never happens again either, as far as that goes. I would rather go out of business to participate in anything like this again.
Violence flared again after a prayer meeting at the courthouse. Shots were fired by snipers in the dark. The mood of the city was one of bitter anger on both sides.
They keep thinking we begging them for something. We ain't begging for nothing. We're telling them what is ours, right now. And we letting them know that we ain't turning real. Like that song Jim sang, we mean that. We'll never turn back.
But they can come in town picket it, but no white people can't go out there. That's one thing right now. That's all I gotta say. It's all one-sided. And the newspapers and a TV camera all one-sided too. They take pictures when they want to take pictures, and they print what they want to print on the other side of town. That's on Pine Street.
I'll bet you that won't get printed.
That's right. Yeah.
Tell them they
won't get
printed.
If I paint myself black, I'd be on TV every night.
3 days after the guardsmen left, they were back. Again, the curfew, stricter this time.
Demonstrations of all types are prohibited. All stores will be closed at 7 p.m. Curfew at 9 p.m.
Please obey the curfew. We will not have demonstrations tonight or a mass rally. We're meeting with the Attorney General of the United States. He's working on some solution for Cambridge. So please, obey the curfew. Please obey the curfew.
Guardsmen used tear gas to break up another Negro protest, and even guardsmen became the targets of the snipers. The shockwaves of the violence reached even to the White House. President Kennedy rebuked the demonstrators for having lost sight of their objectives. Governor Taws appealed for a solution to satisfy what he called the legitimate pleas of Negroes for equality. Finally, on July 23rd, a solution was announced in Washington after long hours of hard bargaining directed by Attorney General Robert Kennedy. It called for completion of desegregation in public schools, formation of a biracial committee, construction of a federally sponsored housing project, a Negro interviewer at the state employment office, and a controversial amendment to the city charter providing for desegregation of public accommodation.
Okay, so
As we enter into our conversation, our learning, our exploration around the Cambridge movement, we thought it might be helpful to start off by giving a little context and learning a little bit more about Cambridge, Maryland. And so I'm going to share a little bit about Cambridge. So Cambridge is the seat of historically conservative Dorchester County, Maryland. It's a 2-hour drive from Baltimore across the Chesapeake Bay Bridge and south along US 50 through the heart of the Eastern Shore. And so here's a map of Maryland that gives you an idea of sort of where Dorchester County is and Cambridge in proximity to Montgomery County. So Cambridge was settled by English colonists in 1864. The first Black residents of Dorchester County came as indentured servants on Dutch merchant ships. They came to an area that was already inhabited by the indigenous Choptank people. And here's a picture of a state road sign, a marker that actually states that Cambridge was originally part of the Choptank Indian Reservation, which was created in 1669. We just thought that was an interesting piece of the history of Cambridge. So the first Black residents of Dorchester, by the mid-1800s, half of Dorchester County's Black population was free. And so Dorchester's free Black people purchased land along the rivers in the southern parts of the county, with white people living on the other side of the county. It's worth noting that the Eastern Shore had more free Blacks than just about any other slaveholding area in the nation. Part of this had to do with the region's high number of Quakers and who mostly freed their enslaved laborers. Also, many free Blacks fled from Virginia to Maryland to live in the area. It's also worth noting that the need for slave labor was lower on the Eastern Shore because of soil depletion and other economic factors. The Eastern Shore had a unique identity as a slave-holding region that actually had relatively few slaves and a high number of free Black people. Some historians think this uniqueness may have led to the high number of Black revolutionaries that came out of the area, including Harriet Tubman, Frederick Douglass, and the activist that we're going to be talking about later this evening. And I just have a piece up. There was an article in the Washington Post back in 2018 that actually talked about the high number of Black revolutionaries from the Eastern Shore. So while the 1865 abolition of slavery sent the economies of many slave-owning regions into a tailspin, Cambridge was able to remain afloat largely due to a robust canning and packing industry. Canning started in the region with the canning of oysters and fruit to extend their selling life. And later, crab picking operations opened that would ultimately revolutionize the way we buy, prepare, and eat crabs. And so the photo that you're seeing right now is actually a picture of an oyster cannery. So while the economy remained stable, Cambridge was a deeply racially segregated and inequitable city. Long after the Supreme Court ruled in 1954 that public school segregation was unconstitutional, Cambridge maintained separate schools for the races. Archaic housing laws limited African Americans to living in the historically Black Second Ward west of Ray Street, which was the unofficial dividing line between the Black and white communities. And this grainy photo that you're looking at is actually a picture of an early protest in the Second Ward. Cambridge's economy relied heavily on the Phillips Packing Company, which by the 1930s had become one of the largest manufacturing operations on the Eastern Seaboard, employing over a quarter of Cambridge's 8,000 residents. Generations of Blacks and poor whites earned their living at the company. So when it closed down in the 1960s, it was devastating to the town's economy. The Washington Post reported one Black resident as saying, The Eastern Shore had always been segregated, but it didn't seem like a day-to-day problem when everyone had a job and someplace to go. When the jobs left, the issues bubbled up to the surface. So next, we're going to be watching a video clip. It's called Counter Histories, Cambridge, Maryland, and it explores what happened when those issues did bubble up.
Disneyland was one of the rough spots. 9 times out of 10, there was going to be trouble. The younger people would picket outside, and the older guys would go inside. You could hear the door lock behind them once they got inside. And that's when the trouble started.
Times were very turbulent. My father kept a pistol in his boot, a knife in his pocket, a shotgun in the trunk, a rifle under the front seat, and a handgun in his pocket. That was to protect us and to protect himself. It was a time when everyone carried a weapon because you just weren't sure who might approach you to hurt you.
Cambridge had been, say, at mid-century, or around World War II, this somewhat almost booming industrial company town dominated by something called the Phillips Packing Company. And then that company had collapsed in the 1950s. So as the 60s dawned, it was an economically depressed city. I think the black population's unemployment was around 30%. On the other hand, people in Cambridge, maybe not the black community, but much of the white community, thought of themselves as being a somewhat progressive community. They didn't see that civil rights movement was going to come to them.
I remember Gloria Richardson. She's now Gloria Richardson Dandridge. She was, in my estimation as a little girl, the most beautiful woman, the most powerful woman I'd ever seen.
I can see Gloria Richardson now, like a general, holding up her hand, and at the command of her hand, things would stop. She put her life on the line, all the threats she received, and bomb threats, and threats on her children's lives. But she did a wonderful job as a leader, and nobody has been able to come and take her place since.
The whole American good citizenship thing, you know, you petition, you write a letter, none of that worked. We had voted since mid-1850s. We'd had representation. The strategy was on the other things first, to get them to totally desegregate the schools, desegregate the faculties, desegregate the transportation. So there were a lot of everyday living issues that were affecting people. Them, as they said, going into some little shoddy restaurant.
There are protests, there are counter-protests taking place, and it leads to the National Guard coming in to Cambridge and staying there virtually for an entire year. And I think what catches people's attention about Disneyland is that the national newspapers capture this photograph of someone smashing an egg over a nonviolent protester's head. The press says, oh, it's Disneyland, not realizing that the bigger issues are this other stuff. It's not the hamburger per se. This notion is you need the money for the hamburger in the first place. And that didn't want people to think just because now you had access to these restaurants that the movement was going to be over. Quite the contrary, if you didn't have jobs and if you didn't have income, you know, what would be the point of the access? Ultimately, Disneyland gets desegregated. But that didn't address the issue necessarily of jobs or housing.
July something rather, 2008, I became the first woman and the first black woman to be in the 300 and something history of the city to be elected mayor. And it wasn't just a black vote. It was a citywide vote.
I thought when I heard she was running that she was crazy. Well, I thought, God, where does she get the nerve to do that? In Cambridge. And then when she won, I thought, my God, 5 wards voted for her? What? You may think of that when you're out fighting, but you don't, when it becomes a reality.
Things have changed in the sense that we can enter any store, any restaurant. If your money is green, you can have what you want. However, there is still poverty, there's still ignorance, there's still that racism in our soil.
Cambridge reminds us that there were issues that were not overcome in the 1960s.
We've come a long ways, but yet we have a long ways to go. I wish more of our younger people would research and go back into the history, and then they can know, you know, this movement grew out of a great struggle. Great struggle.
Okay. So in that clip, we are introduced to the activist Gloria Richardson. And so next, we want to dig a little bit more into her background and just share a little bit more of her story. So I'm going to share my screen here again. So, civil rights activist Gloria Hayes Richardson was born Gloria St. Clair Hayes on May 6, 1922 in Baltimore, Maryland, to parents John and Mabel Hayes. Her parents were part of the Black elite. Her father was a pharmacist and her mother was an educator. In the picture that you see here, the child is Gloria Richardson, and holding her hand is her mother. And actually the other two people, the gentleman in the picture is Gloria's uncle, and the other woman is Gloria's mother's cousin. So during the Great Depression, her parents moved the family to Cambridge, Maryland, which was where Gloria's mother was originally from. Young Gloria grew up in a very privileged environment. Her grandfather, Herbert M. St. Clair, was actually one of the town's wealthiest citizens. And we were able to find this picture of the family home. This is actually Gloria Richardson's grandparents' home in Cambridge. So her grandfather owned numerous properties in the city's second ward, which included a funeral parlor, a grocery store, and a butcher shop. He was also the sole African-American member of the Cambridge City Council through most of the early 20th century. So Gloria attended Howard University in Washington, D.C. at the age of 16, and she graduated in 1942 with a degree in sociology. And here's a picture of Gloria in college. Gloria is on the right, and that is an unnamed friend of hers on the left. After Howard, she worked as a civil servant for the federal government in World War II era Washington, D.C., but returned to Cambridge after the war. Despite her grandfather's political and economic influence, the Maryland Department of Social Services, for example, refused to hire Hayes or any other Black social workers. So Gloria, upon returning home, she married local school teacher Harry Richardson in 1948, and they had two daughters, Donna and Tamara. And so here are some photos from an Ebony magazine from the era. We have a picture of Gloria with her daughter Tamara on the left and Gloria with her daughter Donna on the right. So in her early married years, Gloria faced a lot of challenges. First of all, she was unhappy in this marriage. Also, her father died of a heart condition that was exacerbated by the fact that the segregated hospital in Cambridge would not treat him. And so we have a picture here of a postcard from the era that has that depicts the Cambridge, Maryland hospital, which at the time was segregated. Additionally, she was facing some financial struggles because she was trying to run her late father's pharmacy. And also after her grandfather died as a result of injuries from a car accident in a vehicle, Her grandfather died as a result of injuries from a car accident in a vehicle that her husband was driving. And a biography that I was reading of her mentioned that she actually blamed her husband for her grandfather's death. And so all of these things came together, and ultimately in 1960, Gloria divorced her husband. And so for the next couple of years, Gloria's work focused on advocacy around local issues, examples for racial equity in school funding, and she also worked to try to get county funding for a recreation league for the second ward. It was this type of advocacy work that she did for about 5 or 6 years until she was catapulted onto a larger stage by events that we'll hear more about in our next clip. And that clip is called Meet Gloria Richardson.
Why do you think this photo is so iconic?
I have no idea. Maybe because there was a woman pushing away a gun.
I refer to her as a silent warrior and a general. She didn't lead you in the wrong direction. She led you, I'm going to say, to the path of freedom.
She became known through our community as the leader of our civil rights movement, the mother, if you will.
Cambridge, Maryland was segregated, with Race Street dividing the blacks from the whites.
They had a restaurant right there called Disneyland. You couldn't go in there and sit down or get nothing.
She changed all of that. All of it.
She was different than most of the other leaders. She was a middle-aged woman. She was militant. She was savvy. She was from the community. She led a community-based movement. But because she's also different than the way we often think of the movement, we don't know that much about her.
This woman had passion. She had a plan. Plus, she wasn't alone. She had people backing her up to say, you can do it. I've got your back. I'm with you.
When this photo is taken, there had been weeks after weeks of protests in the streets.
Hundreds of people were on the other side of that picture in the background. We usually had something going on daily, demonstrations, marches, picketing. When we were out that day, we heard what I thought were bullets. And I was crossing to find out what had happened.
She defied the white power structure here. They had always expected the black leaders to hold the peace and hold the order. They're saying, okay, if you guys agree to call off your protests, we'll negotiate with you. And she said, no, you're not going to negotiate with us unless we're on the streets, unless we're marching.
Oh, I didn't believe in nonviolence if people would come and shooting into your houses.
Gloria worked the street, but she didn't work just Pine Street. Remember, she was all over the place. She was in Washington. She went to New York. She went down south. Women were definitely behind her. So she could take the lead, and the men saw the strength in her and followed her.
I think as much was achieved there as, say, in Birmingham, which gets a lot more, you know, press and media and historical attention.
When she spoke, people knew that she meant business and she was in charge.
It was just people whose lives were at stake and in danger. And it was a life and death situation almost every day.
Okay, so I am going to present on how Gloria Richardson became more politically active, specifically her role in the Cambridge Nonviolent Action Committee, also known as CNAC, and the shift in tone and tactics from nonviolence to self-defense. And so first, what we wanted to provide was to kind of zoom out a little bit in understanding that in 1960, Black college students founded the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, also known as SNCC. The organization was dedicated to ending segregation and giving young Black people a stronger voice in the civil rights movement. SNCC members participated in freedom rides, and these were trips taken on interstate buses to challenge the segregation of restrooms, restaurants, and waiting rooms of bus stations. In the summer of 1961, sit-ins and freedom rides began along Route 40 in Maryland's Eastern Shore. Some of the civil rights groups in Eastern Shore during the early 1960s were the Baltimore Civic Interest Group, and they were an affiliate of SNCC, and the Congress of Racial Equity, also known as CORE. When SNCC came to Cambridge, Maryland, Gloria Richardson's grandfather and cousin helped post the bond for protesters. Gloria got involved with the movement when a group of high school students, including her daughter Donna, began holding demonstrations and boycotts to disrupt the local economy and protest segregated spaces. Next slide. And so during this time, the students were really involved, but they grew discouraged after a few months when their message fell on deaf ears and their peaceful approach was met with violence. The local newspaper was also very critical of these student protesters, and they likened them to when cancer invades a healthy organism. So when the SNCC-led protests faltered in 1962, Gloria Richardson and other parents created the Cambridge Nonviolent Action Committee, CNAC, which became the only adult-led SNCC affiliate in the civil rights organization's history. And CNAC expanded the scope of the movement to fight against housing and employment discrimination and to fight for adequate health care. Gloria Richardson was selected to lead the CNAC. The CNAC differed from SNCC in one key area, self-defense. Gloria Richardson is quoted as saying, we weren't nonviolent. White folks would come there shooting at your houses and people responded. And so during this time, as CNAC challenged Jim Crow head on with increasing intensity, white mobs regularly attacked the protesters. Race Street, which separated the city's black community and white community, became a battle zone. One supporter said, by the time we got to town, Cambridge's blacks had stopped praising the virtues of passive resistance. Guns were carried as a matter of course, and it was understood that they would be used. And so the next video clip, I believe there's also a quote right there on, there's a quote on her picture there that says, we weren't going to stop until we got it. And if violence occurred, then we would have to accept that. And so we are going to show the next clip, which provides a little bit more context, and it's called The Civil Rights Heroine with a More Radical Approach. And this is going to take us specifically through the next 5 years of not just Gloria Richardson, but the CNAC's activism.
Thank you. Okay, this takes us to my portion of the presentation where I will go into detail a little bit about the immediate dynamics and events that preceded the Treaty of Cambridge, and also elaborate a little bit on the clips you've just watched that gave us a little bit of information about the treaty. The conditions that gave rise to the Cambridge Treaty differed from the civil rights movement further below the Mason-Dixon line and merited different responses from government officials in Washington, D.C., who were embarrassed about the situation of Cambridge, given its proximity to the nation's capital. At the time in the Deep South, the focus was on desegregation and voting rights, whereas in Cambridge, the focus was on jobs, housing, and education, according to Joseph R. Fitzgerald, author of The Struggle is Eternal, Gloria Richardson, and Black Liberation. Black residents in Cambridge already had the right to vote, but a significant portion of the Black population lived in chicken shacks, lacked basic plumbing, and had to drive 2 hours to Baltimore, Maryland for adequate medical care because they were denied entry to the local hospital on the basis of their race. It was under these conditions that the Cambridge movement of the 60s emerged. Led by the CNAC, Cambridge activists picketed and performed sit-ins at public white establishments that did not hire Black people. In response, mobs of white people physically assaulted the protesters, and ironically enough, Ray Street was the primary site of the conflict. Moreover, the harsh mishandling of two Black teenagers, Dwight Cromwell and Dinez White, who prayed at a segregated bowling alley in Cambridge, drove the conflict to a boiling point. Judge E. McMaster Brewer presided over the teenagers' cases and leveled punishments that prompted Richardson to reach out to then U.S. Attorney General Robert F. Kennedy and the U.S. Civil Rights Commission to intervene. Richardson said in a telegram to Kennedy and the Civil Rights Commission that failure to act may bring about the very violence we are trying to prevent. The judge had once dismissed cases against four white men accused of lynching a Black man in Princess Anne back in 1933. So the Black community in Cambridge was not optimistic regarding the situation of the teenage protesters. The teenage protesters were then sentenced to a reformatory, which angered Black residents. The following month, many protesters clashed with racists, to which Governor Taws held a meeting offering to speed up school desegregation, improvement of public housing, and form a biracial commission if protests ended. The CNAC rejected this deal, believing it to be inauthentic. The governor then declared martial law and sent troops into Cambridge to subdue protesters. The National Guard remained in Cambridge for nearly a month, then left for several days, and then returned when hundreds of racists threatened protesters during a march to the courthouse. The National Guard was present in Cambridge for the following year. Gloria Richardson's leadership qualities and mobilization of Cambridge activists in the midst of increasing racist tensions garnered the attention of the Kennedy administration, and not all for positive reasons. Richardson stated that people within the Kennedy administration threatened to reveal private information about her and her separation from her ex-husband in an effort to get her to leave the movement. In response, Richardson tapped into her network of Black professionals who had ties to Washington, D.C., and gathered her own information regarding the Kennedys' family affairs, thusly posing too great a risk to challenge her. Also, the Kennedy administration questioned the tactics of the Cambridge movement, to which Richardson asserted, as we've heard before, that they were nonviolent, but when attacked, they employed self-defense. Despite this conflict, the Treaty of Cambridge was signed on July 23, 1963, between the Justice Department, city officials, and civil rights organizations. The treaty called for the appointment of a human relations commission, desegregation of schools and hospitals, construction of low-rent public housing, and the Maryland Department of Employment Security and the Post Office hiring Black workers, and also an amendment to the city charter to desegregate public spaces. Unfortunately, during discussions to establish the agreements of the treaty, Cambridge's local government rejected going forward with the deal and argued that the procedures of the agreement had to be approved by a public referendum, a general vote by which an electorate votes on a single issue. Gloria Richardson called for a boycott of the vote, which alienated her from civil rights entities, but also attracted the support of Black power advocates. In Richardson's view, the rights of Black people were non-negotiable, and white power structures had no right to deny them their agency. And as we've seen before, in her words, human rights are human rights, not white rights. She believed that even if the amendment was passed, the power holders in Cambridge would find a way to legally challenge the treaty's proposed measures. White voters turned out in record numbers, and the referendum passed, halting the agreements of the treaty. The CNAC continued their struggle, and the white racist majority persisted. Although the 1964 Civil Rights Act helped some of the agreements come to fruition. However, following the passage of the act, the CNAC's activity decreased. But nonetheless, the Cambridge's movement and the philosophy of resistance improved the quality of life for people on the Eastern Shore and exemplified the capacity of people to organize, inspire, and hold people in power accountable. So for this next segment, we're going to take you to this clip, The Side Eye That Changed the Culture. You may have seen this photo of Gloria Richardson pushing away a gun, circulating across social media. So here we have a video going into a little detail about it.
One of the most iconic pictures of Black women, what she does best, with a simple glance letting you know she has a time and is not one to mess with, because she will always stand and fight for the rights of her people, is Gloria Richardson giving the illest side eye while pushing a National Guard's bayonet away. Inspirational and a model for all smart brown girls. As it is Black History Month, let's get into this piece of history and the iconic woman behind the image. Gloria Richardson is a Howard alumni from Eastern Shore, Maryland, more specifically Cambridge, Maryland, where she became heavily involved in the civil rights movement after her daughter joined the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC. Initially, Richardson, coming from a family well-established in town, wasn't very involved. Rather, she was watching. But as the young members of SNCC, SNCC, took on the civil rights battle cry, going a step further than the more planned marches of Martin Luther King, their commitment to heavily, almost daily protesting for desegregation pushed Richardson to get involved. Shall we take a minute to think about the context of today? Because of the protesting, the National Guard came into Cambridge, and after 18 months in support of SNCC, Richardson, along with other parents, formed the SNCC-adjacent group, the Cambridge Movement, the only adult group to officially support SNCC. And as Richardson has noted, the NAACP was ineffective because of classisms in the organization. The Cambridge Movement is most notable for being one of the first civil rights groups to take head-on the fight for economic equality and social justice, helping to spearhead the evolution of the civil rights movement into the Black Power era. Richardson helped to broker the Treaty of Cambridge with U.S. Attorney General Robert Kennedy and the Department of Justice. Richardson got the federal government to agree to five demands, including...
In terms of five demands we had, desegregate the hospital, cross-desegregate the schools and the buses, provide new housing, and one or two other things.
Then came the August 1963 landmark March on Washington, where Martin Luther King gave his impassioned I Have a Dream speech, but also where Black women were almost entirely erased from the main stage of the march. Daisy Bates, the organizer of the Little Rock Nine, was the only one to speak for a little over a minute, pledging that
this country, Mr. Randolph, pledged to you, to Martin Luther King, Roy Wilkins, and all of you fighting for civil liberties, that we will join hands with you as women of this country. Rosa Gregg, my president, Dorothy Height, the National Council of Negro Women, the Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, the Methodist Church women, all the women, pledge that we will join hands with you. We will kneel in, we will sit in until we can eat in any corner in the United States.
Only Daisy Bates spoke, though Richardson was handed the mic. It was promptly taken away, and her, along with Lena Horne, were put in a taxi back to the hotel. They did not even have the opportunity to see firsthand King's speech.
So then when they called me, I came from the back, and I was going to tell people to sit there until they passed the law, don't leave town. Mm-hmm. And as I said, hello, and the NAACP guy snatched the mic. Then they took me and Lena Horne, because she had gotten Rosa Parks and was presenting her to the international satellite and things.
Media.
And when I found that out, I went to help her, because there would have been no Martin if it hadn't been Rosa Parks. So I think they were annoyed at both of us. So before Martin spoke, they put us in a taxi and sent us back to the hotels.
And what was the rationale they gave for that?
No, they didn't want us to be crushed.
By the big crowds?
Yes.
Yeah. Getting out.
Well, the rest is everybody else on the platform is okay.
Let's get to this iconic side eye. What do you read it as her thinking? The picture comes from May 1964, back in Cambridge, Maryland, where Richardson, along with the Cambridge movement, are protesting the super bigly bigoted Alabama governor, a segregationist who has noted strong similarities to one, number 45, George Wallace's visit to Cambridge. The National Guard was still stationed in Cambridge, attempting to forcefully keep demonstrations and protests from happening. Richardson recounts that they were tear gassed out of a building, rushing into the street, and a guard came charging at her with his bayonet. And there you have it, a look every Black woman so deeply understands, and a woman who fought so mercilessly for her community. I encourage you to look up the interviews Gloria Richardson has done with Democracy Now!, the Library of Congress, the history of the partnership between the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and the Cambridge Nonviolent Action Committee, or Cambridge Movement, in parallel and other times perpendicular to Martin Luther King and crew, the NAACP, and the Nation of Islam. Remember that although we tend to look up history with rose-colored glasses of everyone who helped for a similar mission that achieved greater good was the best of buddies, and the schisms we see today are something only of this generation, but there is beauty in seeing some of the same natural human afflictions and schisms not stop a movement from becoming something that redefines society and culture at large. So you can understand the power in your role, and that through great effort, change does come. We just have to keep fighting for the greater good. Thank you to the OG, smart brown girl, Gloria Richardson.
And as we prepare to wrap up tonight, I just want to put up a final picture of that smart brown girl that she refers to. A final picture of Gloria Richardson. Here we are. So we feel like Gloria Richardson's legacy is definitely worth lifting up. Despite being active for only 3 years, 1962 to 1964, Richardson had a very important influence on the civil rights and Black power waves of the movement for Black liberation, which makes her unique. And you could say her activism continued when she re-entered the workforce in the late 1960s. She followed a social work career path that was in many ways an extension of her human rights activism. She remarried and settled into life in New York, where she worked as a program officer in the Department of Aging, helping senior citizens. Today, she is still alive. She is 98 years old, and she only entered into active retirement a couple of years ago. As was alluded to in that last video that we saw, there are, she is still doing interviews. There are some videos of her speaking at some universities. So she is still very vocal. So that concludes our presentation on the Cambridge movement and Gloria Richardson. And I think I can say on behalf of Yesenia and Rudy, and certainly myself, we are hoping that people learned as much about the Cambridge movement and Gloria Richardson as we did in organizing this tonight. It was not, she is not a person, and the movement was not something historically that we knew very much about. And so we were very excited to bring this to people tonight. As we mentioned at the opening, we're going to be transitioning to a post-presentation discussion for our Black participants who are with us tonight. Who want to remain for a conversation that is completely optional. So that's, you know, that space is for Black folks who want to be part of a conversation. To everyone else, first, we want to thank you for joining us. And second, we want to invite you to two upcoming Impact Spaces. One, next Thursday, February 25th at 6:30. We will make sure that the time is right this time when you get the Zoom link. At 6:30, we're going to have an online presentation by a local anthropology professor on overcoming housing discrimination in the eastern part of Montgomery County during the civil rights era. And I think Yesenia might be able to drop a link in the chat for the registration. If not, you can check out our Facebook page, Instagram, or our website to get the link to register for that. The second thing I want to invite people to, registration is now open for Impact's Weaver Learning Lab. We describe the Weaver Learning Lab as a space to slow down and take a more holistic approach to addressing racism. There's an emphasis on inner work that leads to more productive outward activism. It's a cohort experience that happens over 5 sessions, and Yesenia is one of our facilitators. I think that she dropped a link in the chat if you are interested in learning more about that. Yesenia, could you say when the Weaver Learning Lab starts? You're muted.
Sorry, it starts on March 20th.
Okay, great.
You can go to the website, and I also absolutely don't mind talking to people one-on-one. Again, the Weaver Learning Lab is a mixed race, cultural, ethnic space.